I'm going to go ahead and call this meeting to order. Welcome, everyone. It's 1 o'clock on Thursday, December 28th. We are gathered here remotely for the Citizens Financial Accountability Oversight Committee. Please note, everyone, that this meeting is being recorded. With that said, I'd like to thank you all for joining us. Before we proceed, I'd like to ask you all to stand if you're able, or if not, you may remain seated, but place your right hand over your heart, and we're going to take the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right, thank you very much. Okay, so before we begin this meeting, there is an administrative matter that we need to attend to. That matter concerns the swearing in of two members, Michelle Gaskell-Haynes and Alfred Rolette. Can I ask the new members also to raise your right hand? I'm going to administer the oath and simply repeat after me, okay? I, state your name.
I, Michelle Gaskell-Haynes.
I, Al Rolette.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support and defend the Constitution.
That I will support and defend the Constitution.
Of the United States.
Of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies.
Against all enemies.
Foreign and domestic.
Foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
To the Constitution of the United States.
To the Constitution.
The Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation
freely.
Without any mental reservation.
Without
any mental reservation.
Or purpose of evasion.
Or purpose of evasion. Vengeance.
And that I will well and faithfully.
And that I will well and faithfully.
Discharge the duties upon which I'm about to enter.
Discharge the duties upon which I'm about to enter.
Fabulous. That was excellent, you guys. Good job. Congratulations on your appointment. We welcome you to the Citizens Financial Accountability Oversight Committee. And most importantly, I appreciate in advance all of your expertise and service to this important oversight body. Now, we will begin by officially calling it to order. Brian Mueller, could you please call the roll?
Good afternoon, Controller Cohen. I will now call roll for the CFAOC members. When your name is announced, please indicate your presence for the record. Chair, State Controller Malia M. Cohen.
Present, Malia Cohen, present.
Michelle Gaskell-Haynes.
Present.
Dr. Jim Lott.
Please let the record reflect that Dr. Lott has asked for an excused absence due to his holiday travel.
Dr. John Ma.
Present.
Alfred Rowlett.
Present.
Dr. Gurbinder Sadana.
Dr. Sadana? Okay, Mr. Mueller, I think we still have quorum even without Dr. Sadana.
Yeah.
Okay.
Present.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
can you hear me now?
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, well, thank you, Mr. Mueller. A quorum has been established. I want to thank everyone for joining us. I'm California State Controller Malia Cohen. It's a pleasure to convene today's meeting as chair of the CFAOC. For me, the role of the state controller is centered on ensuring that every taxpayer dollar is spent wisely, efficiently, and in a way that uplifts all communities. The controller's office is the financial steward of the fourth largest economy in the world, Under my leadership, we oversee the books, the budget, the audits, all of it. So as such, my office conducts the annual Citizens Financial Accountability Oversight Committee meeting. And it is, and this work is very important and serious to ensure that the public dollars are spent appropriately. So for historical purposes, it's important to acknowledge that the CFAOC was created by the passage of Prop 71, the Stem Cell Research and Cures Initiative in 2004, and continued with the passage of 14 in 2020. This annual meeting fulfills the duties assigned to my office, as the CFAOC is charged with discussing the annual expenditures of the available bond funding from Prop 14 and the results of the annual financial audit of the California Institute of Regenerative Medicine, also known as CIRM. So before we discuss the audit review and CIRM's activities, I want to introduce CFAOC's committee members. So please briefly introduce yourself, and I will start with you, Michelle Gaskell-Haynes. Welcome.
Hi, thank you, and it's an honor and a pleasure to serve in this capacity. Michelle Gaskell-Haynes, I am the president for Kaiser Permanente Southern California and Hawaii markets, and looking forward to participating in this regard. I've been so I'm in Southern California now, but have been in Northern California for 7 years prior. So have enjoyed being a Californian and looking forward to serving.
Thank you. Dr. Ma, Dr. John Ma.
Thank you, Controller Cohen. My name is John Ma. I'm a general surgeon at Marin Health Medical Center. I was the 2018 president of the San Francisco Marin Medical Society and work extensively with the California Medical Association. An honor to be appointed by Treasurer Fiona Ma in an important role. Good seeing all of you.
Good to see you too. And Mr. Alfred Roulette.
Thank you very much, Al Roulette. I'm the President and Chief Executive Officer for Turning Point Community Programs, a large behavioral health organization located in Northern and Central California. I also have had the unique privilege of being state speaker appointee as a patient advocate for the California Institute of Regenerative Medicine Board and Medicine Board, and served in that role capacity for approximately 8 years. Currently, am very excited about doing this, and have worked with CIRM regarding their fiscal audit and presentation for the last 2 years of my 8 year term as a patient advocate.
All right, thank you very much. And last but not least, we have Dr. Gubinder Sadana.
Good afternoon. Thank you. It's an honor, Madam Controller, to be on this committee. I've been on this for the last, I lost count, maybe when it was started off as an initial committee. I am a physician, a teaching physician, practicing physician as well, and research, did some with the COVID also and the outcomes, and long-term, we are still working on that. I'm a critical care specialist, a lung and a sleep specialist also. We do have a teaching program where we train fellows in pulmonary and critical care medicine. I was also involved in the current prescription methodology, which is introduced in our state, which is computerized prescription delivery for patients. So those are some of the things which over the years I've done, and have been an honor to be in this committee for all these years and to be involved in this project. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. I appreciate the introductions. Bear with me here. Okay, moving on, we are going to. Forgive me, I lost my space in my notes. Okay, thank you. All right. Again, thanks for your service, everyone. I appreciate you. I'm new to this committee, and I know we have a few new faces as well, so hopefully we'll be able to get to know this work as well as each other in the next upcoming years. So while we hear from CIRM leadership, we will hear from CIRM leadership later. I also want to acknowledge the following agency representatives. We've got Jonathan Thomas, who's the interim president and CEO, and his tenure will be effective January 1st, 2024. We've got Vito Mbassiani, who's the chair, Maria Bonville, who's the vice chair, Puna Simpson, who is the senior director of finance, and Scott Tosher, senior director of board governance. Before we move on into the details of the meeting, I want to reiterate how I am to serve as the chair of this committee and to provide this oversight as I strive to empower Californians with knowledge in order to foster a culture of openness and trust. This type of stewardship is incredibly important as Prop 14 continued California's trust in helping support strategies for solving rare and complicated diseases. So today, it is about the numbers, and so equally important about ensuring that the funds are distributed in a way that serves all communities, especially those that have been historically underserved or marginalized. Our first order of business is item four, the adoption of the minutes dated November 9th, 2022. The CFAOC committee meeting. Has everyone had an opportunity to review the minutes?
Yes.
Yes.
Great. Thank you. Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
All right. A motion has been made. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. So I think the motion was made by Michelle Gaskell Hames and seconded by Dr. Sadella. Is that right?
Yes, correct.
All right. Appreciate that. Mr. Mueller, can you call the roll for the vote?
Yes, Chair Cohen. I will now call roll vote on the motion to approve the minutes for the November 9th, 2022 meeting. When your name is announced, please indicate your vote for the record. Chair Cohen?
Aye.
Ms. Gaskell Hames?
Aye.
Dr. Ma?
Aye.
Mr. Rowlett?
Aye.
Dr. Sedana?
Aye.
Chair Cohen, I will now turn the meeting back over to you.
All right, thank you. Motion passes unanimously. Next up is item five. It's an information item being presented by CIRM staff. This information item will provide a status update on CIRM's financial performance as well as a review of the current budget. So now we will hear from Puna Simpson, Senior Director of Finance from CIRM. Thank you. Puna, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Controller Cohen and members of the CFAOC. I'm Puna Simpson, the Senior Finance Director at CIRM. With every presentation we have, our very first slide after our cover is our mission statement, which is accelerating world-class science to deliver transformative, regenerative medicine treatments in an equitable manner to a diverse California and world. And with that, I will go into the agenda of the materials I will be covering in the next slide. Slide after that is our thank you. So I will provide a very brief overview of Prop 14 and talk about our financial performance in fiscal year 22-23 and our budget for fiscal year 23-24. And finally, we will go into the 21-22 financial audit, which is the purpose of today's call. So with the Prop 14 overview, which is the next slide, I've presented it in this format to share with you the four key buckets that make up Prop 14. So the voters approved $5.5 billion in total, And we divide that into four distinct categories. And I will go clockwise. The state treasurer's office has a set aside of $100 million for the cost of issuance of bonds. That money is not available to CIRM for spending. Next is our general administration. The voters approved $1.3 million for general administration. Our programmatic bucket, which is in gray, includes our grant administration, our access and affordability, and grant compliance for a total of $300 million. And finally, our largest bucket is our research grant dollars, which is $4.9 billion. And I will go over those in the next slide by showing them in this format. The reason we show it in this way is because the voters were very specific and restrictive in how CIRM could spend money. And as you can see, we've started spending some of the Prop 14 dollars, but haven't gotten too far into spending them. So this presentation and the fiscal year budgets will concentrate on the first four pillars, which is the general administration, grants administration, access and affordability, and grant compliance. So in the next slide, we start talking about fiscal year 22-23, which is our the actual budget numbers that we now have since we've closed the fiscal year. But to give you some context in the next slide, I wanted to kind of give you a little bit of background on that fiscal year. We had completed two full years and we're starting our third year of the relaunch, and we were ramping up CIRM. So that included increasing staff levels due to increased workload, increasing the number of reviews based on our ramp up, and moving into a new headquarters in South San Francisco. We were also transitioning out of COVID and starting a hybrid work environment. The resumption of in-person meetings continued, and travel to scientific conferences began once again after the COVID bans were lifted. So in the next slide, we kind of present the budget by laying it out in the seven categories you see in column one. So we explain our budget with regards to these categories. The second column is what was approved by the board for July 1st of 22-23. A budget of $26.2 million. The third column is what actually was spent. And now that we've been able to close the fiscal year, we spent $22.7 million with a variance of $3.4 million. I'll touch on the top three areas where we underspent and the one area that we shifted costs to in the next slide. So with lower expenses, our number one contributor to that was our employee expenses. We were under budget by $2.8 million because of delays in hiring, some staff turnover, and some savings that resulted from employees not putting in transit claims or the per diem that we would have paid for in-person or certain meetings. So the second area is reviews, meetings, and workshops. We were under budget by $921,000. This was due to in-person meetings becoming virtual or certain workshops being postponed. And finally, with office expenses, we were under budget by $469,000 because the actual move costs were lower than the budgeted due to the hard work of our staff and their diligent effort to find lower cost vendors. And some of our costs in this category actually belonged in our external services category, so they were moved, resulting in the savings. In the next slide, we kind of go over the external services increases, which had to do with some consultants for new initiatives, including the IP and industry activities for business development, access and affordability working group roadmap development, facilities working group consultation for developing a new review, some upgrades in IT security and infrastructure, and finally, some automation needed in the finance business processes. Altogether, our expenses in this area were over by $782,000. So moving on to the fiscal year 23-24 ICOC budget. It's our current year, so if you go to the next slide. We presented in the same format as we did the previous year. We show you what was budgeted in 22-23 in the second column, what the actuals ended up being, and then what the board approved in the fourth column for fiscal year 23-24. We have a budget of $28.9 million, which is an increase of $6.2 million over what the actual expenditures were. So again, I'm going to concentrate on the areas where there was a lot of increase and explain what contributed to that in the next slide. So the number one increase in costs is the addition of 6 additional positions, which brings us up to a total of 66 positions in our organization. Also, we've budgeted for reviews, meetings, and workshops to be in person more than we had in the previous year. We have membership and training increase due to staff resuming the pre-pandemic activities of putting on events, and the travel increase for staff resuming their pre-pandemic activities and attending conferences. So the next slide is really the bulk of what the CIRM budget is, which is the research budget, the $4.9 billion I mentioned earlier. This is shown in two categories here. The amount that the board has committed, $881 million so far, and the amount that's remaining for future years to be committed, about $4 billion. In our spring presentation, we will be presenting in depth how we spend these dollars. But in the next slide, I provide a very high level overview of the 5 key pillars of grant funding that CIRM has. Again, in the spring, we will be going into details about each of these pillars and how we fund grants. So the next slide is the access and affordability funding sources. You mentioned access earlier, Controller Cohen. So the focus of today's meeting is the 21-22 audit. And in that audit, you see revenue coming in for the first time for the royalties that CIRM is to collect as part of Prop 14. So there's 3 categories here for access and affordability. There is a 2% set aside in the grants, equaling $96 million for research funding. There's a 1% set aside of $55 million for the administrative portion of this program. And lastly, the new fund that has been established for patient support had a revenue in fiscal year 21-22 of $15.6 million. Its current balance is $16.3 million. And I will go into the last slide, which is the 21-22 financial audit. I will be turning it over to Craig Harner, but wanted to thank all of you for the opportunity to give you an overview of the CIRM's budget, and wish you all a happy new year.
Thank you very much. Let me check in and see if my colleagues have any questions for you. Folks, are there any questions for Ms. Simpson?
You know, I do, if I can ask one question about workforce. I noticed that you had the prior year we underspent in employees, and wondering how we're doing on hiring now. You'd indicated delays in recruitment, and I know as an industry, the healthcare industry has been challenged with that because of the pandemic. So just wanted to check on current status.
Thank you for that question. We have actually been hiring at an incredible pace this year. We have filled the vacancies from prior year, and I think in total we filled 10 positions so far in the first half of this fiscal year. We have 4 vacancies remaining, so that's pretty good for having only had 6 months in the fiscal year.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you.
Are there any other questions? All right, seeing none, thank you. We will continue. We'll continue with our presentations. Thank you, Ms. Simpson, for your presentation. Next up, our next order of business is to review the independent financial audit. We've got Craig Harner, who is here from Macias, Jenny, and O'Connell, who will present the financial audit report and also the findings from the report. Mr. Harner? Are you here?
All right. Thank you. Yes, thank you, Madam Controller.
Great.
My name is Craig Harner. I'm a partner with MGO, or Macias Jeannie and O'Connell. We're the external auditor for CIRM. Just to give the committee a little bit of background, since there are some newer members on it. We've been CIRM's auditor since the first, since it first got created. So back in 2004, when the Prop 71 first got passed, and then 2007 was the first year of the audit. Myself, I've been involved either as a manager or director, and now a partner with CIRM on the CIRM audit engagement since 2015. So I've been presenting to this committee for the last few years. So I just want to say congratulations to all the new members on your appointments, and as well as the Madam Controller. So I'm here today to present the results of our audit of CIRM's financial statements for the fiscal year ended June 30, 2022. And if we move the slide, the financial statement report, to the third page of it, we'll see our what we call our independent auditor's report. So I think Michelle, I think you have control over the slides.
Are you ready to go to the next slide?
Yeah, so if we can go to page 3. Okay, so page 3 starts off our independent auditor's report. This is the 2 or 3 pages long. This is the key piece of information that accompanies a set of financial statements, because it contains our opinion on those financial statements. So our responsibility as an auditor is to plan and perform our audit to obtain what we call reasonable assurance that the financial statements are free from material misstatement. In the scope of our financial statements, we're looking at the stem cell fund, which it's made up of 3 sub funds. We have the 2004, the Prop 71 stem cell fund, the Props 14 2020 stem cell fund, and then the what they call the royalties fund. So the sum of all those 3 parts is that makes up the stem cell fund presented in the on the face of the financial statements. excuse me. So we performed our audit in accordance with generally accepted auditing standards and also government auditing standards. And if we go to the page 5, you'll see we issued our report on November 4th, 2022, and we issued what's called an unmodified opinion on those financial statements. An unmodified opinion is the highest level of assurance that an external auditor can give an organization regarding the fair presentation of their financial statements. And with that, as I mentioned, the last thing I want to touch on is the reporting required by government auditing standards paragraph, which is the last paragraph here. This is when we perform audits in accordance with government auditing standards, we have to consider internal controls over financial reporting and then compliance with laws, regulations, grant agreements that could have a material effect on some of the amounts in the financial statements. In this case, the biggest laws are the 2 propositions that created the agency, and then the one that extended it, because there's a lot of different compliance requirements of how the grant expenditures, who they can be provided to, what they can be used for, and so on. So we take that into account as part of our audits to make sure that it's not being used, or that they are being used for their intended purpose and being given to entities that are eligible to receive them. So with that, we didn't have any non-compliance with laws and regulations as part of our audit, and also we didn't have any deficiencies in internal controls that would be required to be reported to the different committees that we report to. And then, so with that, I'll kind of wrap up my presentation on the financial statements. And if there's any questions, I'm more than happy to answer.
Thank you. Collins, do we have any questions for Mr. Harner? All right, if not, I'll jump in to begin the questions. I'm interested in the management discussion and the analysis section of the audit report, which indicates that between June 30th, 2021, to June 30th, 2022, the net position of the California Institute, or CIRM, decreased from $90 million cash and investment balance decreased by 92 million, and the revenues decreased by 250 million, and expenses increased by 30 million. And I just wanted to check and see, is that a cause for concern, or is this normal behavior, normal changes and fluctuation?
No, it's not. It wasn't normal. A good question. It wasn't normal for that year. What happened was they didn't. If we go to page 9, we can kind of see what was going on the chart there on the analysis. If we bring it back up. Okay. So this is a summarized version of the financial statements, and what we can see is that in 2022, Serum didn't receive any general obligation bond revenue, whereas in the 2021, it was about $285 million. And if we look down, the expenses crept up. So we still, so they were really dipping into their reserves to pay for the research grant expenditures and their admin expenses in 22. 23, this will go back to normal, where we're seeing general obligation bond revenue coming into the entity. And I believe so that's, so it's not normal for 22, but it should start to normalize itself out as the $5.5 billion in approved bonds are starting to be issued and supplied to Serum.
Okay. Question, if you could just look retrospectively, during the pandemic, was it difficult to sell bonds? What was the climate like?
I'm probably not the right person to ask on that.
I can answer that.
We
didn't have any problem selling our first two bonds, which were during the pandemic. It was not a problem at all. It was very favorable, actually, for bond sellers.
That's good to know. All right, let me see. Colleagues, any other questions for Mr. Harner?
None? Mr. Harner, I have a question.
Please.
So in summary, this is a clean opinion and a reflection of, as you just described it, an unmodified opinion by your firm. And so, again, it reflects that because I assume that the staff internal controls were appropriate given the size of the organization and reflective of what is expected of a state agency, and in keeping with what the proposition states that the staff, again, this is a good, even a congratulatory audit, as I appreciated it.
Yes, very well said. As in the coming years, as you're on the committee, you might hear something. Sometimes there's kind of been a joke that Serum is the most audited entity in the state. And that's because all of their transactions get reviewed by the Serum staff first. They get sent over to the state controller's office, where they get reviewed with the supporting documentation to be paid and approved. Then there's us who come in and audit the transactions again too. So by the time that we're seeing them, they've been approved 2 or 3 times already. So there's a very strong set of, I would say, segregation of duties and internal controls in place, especially over the disbursements.
The second question, if I may, Controller.
Please.
As you implied in your opening remarks, which again, I appreciate it very much, access and affordability is an important part of what the organization does. And in future presentations, it would be important, I think, for this group to hear a little bit more about how underserved or not well-served communities are being engaged in what I believe is, what I hope is a very effective manner, and how those dollars are being utilized through the Access and Affordability Working Group.
Okay, yeah, we can work with, I think the most important place for that would be in management's discussion and analysis section, probably being the most important, since that gives them the opportunity to kind of discuss what went on during the year, where the dollars went. So we can work with Pune and her team on that going forward.
Thank you. That's the end of my questions and comments.
Thank you very much, Pune. If you could make just a mental note of Mr. Rolette's comment. Okay.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Are there any other questions? All right. Well, thank you, Mr. Harner. Next, we're going to hear from a member on my team, Kimberly Tarvin. She is an audit division chief. Ms. Tarvin, thank you very much for being here today. So on behalf of the State Controller's Office, she will be providing a presentation on the quality control of Macias, Ginny, and O'Connell's audit for the fiscal year ending June 30th, 2022. Ms. Tarvin, the floor is yours.
All right. Thank you, Madam Controller. As you said, I'm Kim Tarvin. I'm the chief over the State Controller Office's Division of Audits. And I'm here today to share information regarding the annual quality control reviews over the financial statement audits at the CIRM, which, as you just heard, have several steps of being audited. And then this is like our audit of the auditors. So there you go. This quality control review is required by Health and Safety Code, and it establishes this requirement for the SCO to conduct the annual quality control reviews of the CPA firm that performs the annual CIRM financial statement audit. So the State Controller's Office conducted the quality control review of Macias, Ginny, and O'Connell's financial statement audit at the CIRM for the fiscal year June 30th, 2022, which was just presented by Mr. Harner. We issued our report on August 14th, 2023, and it's included in the meeting materials, if anyone would like to see the copy. So the annual quality control review provides the public with additional information that they can use to assess the reliability of the financial statement audit reports. The State Controller's Office quality control review concluded that Macias, Ginny, and O'Connell conducted the audit of the CIRM's financial statements for fiscal year ended June 2022 in accordance with the three required professional auditing standards, which Mr. Harner mentioned, but I'll mention again. The auditing standards generally accepted in the United States of America, which are published by the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants. The second one is government auditing standards, which are issued by the Comptroller General of the United States and also the California Business and Professions Code. So there's quite a few things that they need to comply with. So to conduct the quality control review, the State Controller's Office compared the Macias, Ginny, and O'Connell's audit working papers, which document the details of the audit work performed, to the three professional audit standards that I just mentioned to verify the CPA firm complied with the professional auditing standards as required when conducting the audit and preparing the financial statement audit reports. As previously mentioned, Macias, Ginny, and O'Connell conducted the audit of the CIRM for June 3rd, 2022 in accordance with these required standards. So thank you, Madam Controller, for the opportunity to share the results of the SCO's quality control review of the CIRM that was conducted by Macias, Ginny, and O'Connell.
Great. Thank you very much for your presentation. I have a quick clarifying question. Does the quality control review involve re-performing the work of the independent CPA firm?
No. So as I kind of mentioned earlier, it's really an audit of the auditors, a review of the auditors. So the purpose isn't to redo all of their work, because there is definitely a lot of work that goes into a financial statement audit, including the internal controls and compliance that could impact the financial statements. But the purpose of the quality control is really to verify that the independent CPA firm met all those audit standards and did all the procedures that they need to do, including, you know, getting their required training and et cetera. So, for example, the working papers prepared by the independent auditor should document the work in enough detail that a reviewer, which would be in our quality control review, could identify the specific transactions or the data that they reviewed, understand the results and analysis, and then how the auditor arrived at their conclusion. So, you know, also just for information, the financial statement audits are conducted on a sample basis, right? So they're not required to include every single document that they see or that they review, but they're required to clearly identify specific procedures performed, which transactions they looked at, and evidence that supports their conclusions. So that's really what the quality control review does.
Okay, I appreciate that clarity. Colleagues, are there any other questions for Ms. Tarvin? Okay, I don't think so. Thank you very much, Kim. I appreciate the presentation. So, colleagues, while these items are listed as an informational item on today's agenda, I would like to suggest that we strongly believe, or I strongly believe, that the committee's work is significant. So what I'd like to do in the future is go beyond simply receiving the CIRM audit report, but we as a committee will formally adopt the audit report, exercising a little bit more oversight capacity. So in the future meetings, we can reconsider this item as an action item to formally adopt the audit. And then as we take action items, we also take public comment on action items. So that would also give a little transparency into the work that we're doing. So with that said, I'd like to pivot to item 7. An important portion of the meeting is to hear and receive public comment. And remember, we are here to serve as stewards of the public's trust. So I'd like to hear what the public is thinking, if anything at all. So I'd like to specifically open up for public comment. I'd like to invite any of the CIRM leadership team members who are not on today's agenda an opportunity to offer a public comment at this time. Is there any public comment? Mr. Mueller, are you handling this portion of the agenda?
I wasn't made aware, but I could do a roll call or a roll call on something if you like.
No roll call is needed. We may not have any public comment at this time. Are there any CIRM leadership team members on the call that like to speak? All right, well, thank you. I hope the members of the public feel free to engage in all of our future meetings. And I wanna just check in to see if any of the FAOC members, if there's any comments that you'd like to say on the record. All right, if not a problem. So that brings us to the bottom of our agenda. This is item number 9, which is adjournment. So all of the necessary oversight functions have been completed for this calendar year, but I'd like to imagine that fellow CFAOC members are interested in a more update and in-depth understanding of the CIRM functions that are typically discussed in a meeting. So for that reason, I'm going to ask for a continuance of this meeting so that we can have CIRM leadership back to this committee so that they can share with us the progress of CIRM strategy plan, programmatic changes, clinical trials, grants awarded, and any fun things that CIRM has in the near future, which also includes their priority on DEI efforts. Now that all the business is concluded today, we can continue this meeting, and we will reconvene in February. 2024, the meeting notice with the date and time will be posted 10 days prior to the meeting. And again, I just want to thank you again for your dedicated service and participation. I really appreciate the work that we're going to do together to promote good governance. It's my goal to ensure that our financial system works for everyone. So thank you for all of your work. Have a great afternoon and a rest of the holiday season. I hope.
Ms. Cohen? Excuse me, it looks like we have a couple hands up by Mr. Ma and Ms. Simpson.
Okay, no problem. I just didn't see that. Thank you. Dr. Ma?
Thank you, Ms. Controller. I was just going to amplify. I was going to ask a question about the recent leadership change at CIRM and the direction, anticipated increased expenses related to a national search and any change in its future vision. But you announced that we'll be February, so I think we can bring that up at that time. So thank you. I think you answered my question.
Okay, sure. Ms. Simpson.
I think the Chair, Dr. Vito Imbasciani is on. He just can't saying he's not being heard. I don't know if it's muted, but he did message me that he is on.
Okay, let's see. Is there an operator or someone that can unmute the line for public comment?
Yes, if you would like to provide public comment today, please press 10 at this time. And that command again is 1, then 0. All right, I have a public comment from Vito Ambascasini with CIRM. Just please go ahead.
Hey, thank you. Controller Cohen, this is Dr. Ambasciani. I'm the fairly new and newly installed chair of CIRM, having served 8 years at the governor's cabinet, Governor Brown and Governor Newsom. And Governor Newsom nominated me to take over this position, which is a perfect place for a physician to find myself. I just want to compliment you on the working relationship we have with your office. And having dealt with Little Hoover Commission and state auditors and other auditors, it is music to my ears to be told that we are the poster child of how audits are on the findings of auditors of state organizations. So thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you very much for coming online. We look forward to welcoming you in February.
Thank you.
All right. Colleagues, any other last minute questions? No? All right. Well, with that, my friends, we can adjourn. It's 1:47. In the afternoon, and I hope you have a great rest of your day. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.